Hello friends, in this video we will see a frequency response of the system. Also we will see response given by LTI system to sinusoidal inputs and some numericals also. Let us begin. First of all, we will understand a area property for frequency domain. In last video lecture, we have already seen area property, but that was related to time domain. So when we were studying area property in last video lecture, since it was in time domain, we used a Fourier transform formula. Here I am going to use inverse Fourier transform formula. Let us see. By inverse Fourier transform, we get x of t from x of omega. So x of t is equal to 1 upon 2 pi. Integrating over minus infinity to infinity x of omega e to the power positive j omega t d omega. Am I right? Now here at t equal to 0, what is going to happen? See, x of 0 is equal to 1 upon 2 pi integrating over minus infinity to infinity x of omega. So wherever there is t, we have to replace with 0. Therefore, it will become e to the power 0 d omega. You know that e to the power 0 is what? 1. So what I'll do is, I'll shift this 2 pi to left hand side. So it will become 2 pi times x of 0 is equal to integrating over minus infinity to infinity x of omega d omega. So please understand this. Integrating x of omega from minus infinity to infinity is as good as area of x of omega. So if you want to calculate area of x of omega, you can calculate this way, that is 2 pi times small x of 0, where x of 0 is nothing but x of t at t equal to 0. In last video lecture, we have seen how to get area for x of t, that is signal in time domain. Let me remind you what we did there. If you want to get area under the curve for x of t, that is from minus infinity to plus infinity, x of t dt, it was simply capital X of 0, where capital X of 0 means it is actually x of omega at omega equal to 0. So this property we have already seen in last video lecture. So this is actually area of signal x of t, that is signal in time domain, and this is area for x of omega. So area for x of omega is 2 pi times x of t at t equal to 0, and area for x of t, it's simply x of omega at omega equal to 0. So I'm sure now area property is quite clear to you. We'll move ahead. Now we will see energy of signal in time as well as frequency domain. For time domain, we have already studied energy, which is given as integrating over minus infinity to infinity mod of x of t whole square dt. This formula we have already seen in chapter 1, where we have studied energy signals and power signals, and we used to calculate energy as well as power for given signals. So there we have already seen this formula. So this is energy which is related to time domain. If the signal is given in time domain, then we can calculate energy. Also for frequency domain, we can calculate energy by this formula, that is energy equal to 1 upon 2 pi integrating from minus infinity to plus infinity mod of x of omega square d omega. So as you can see, the formula is almost same. The only difference, the presence of 1 upon 2 pi in case of frequency domain. So why we are doing this? Just because, suppose if you want to calculate energy of the signal from x of t, then you can use the first formula. And let's say if the signal is not given in time domain, but it is given in frequency domain, and still if you are interested to get energy of the signal, then you can use a second formula. Now the question is, do you think that whether you use first formula or second formula, will you get the same answer? Of course, yes, you will get the same answer. And this is what we called as a Parseval's theorem. A Parseval's theorem says that energy content in time domain as well as frequency domain is always same, because we know the fact that energy cannot be created nor be destroyed. In fact, x of omega is nothing but x of t's transformation. Am I right? Whenever you do a Fourier transform of x of t, you get x of omega. So signal is not different. Signal is still same. Only the representation of the signal, that is domain of the signal, is different. So energy content would be again same. So the point is, whether you use a first formula or second formula, you get the same answer. So both are equal by value. This is according to a Parseval's theorem. Fine. Now we shall see a frequency response of LTI system. So what is meant by frequency response? Let us understand. So assume that you have LTI system, that is linear as well as time invariant system. Assuming input is x of t, output of the system is y of t, and h of t is an impulse response. And of course, I'm sure you remember what is the relation between x of t, h of t, and y of t. So most of the time, input is known to me, h of t would be already known to you, and you have to, let's say, calculate y of t. Then we relate y of t with x of t and h of t as y of t is equal to x of t convolve with h of t. So we write this way, y of t is equal to x of t convolution with h of t. Let's say if I'm taking Fourier transform on both the sides. So what you will get? Y of t will become y of omega. So this is a Fourier transform for y of t equal to x of t will become x of omega. You know very well, convolution in time domain becomes product in frequency domain, or multiplication in frequency domain, and h of t becomes h of omega. Is that right? Now finally, I can write h of omega as y of omega upon x of omega. Now let me tell you, the ratio of y of omega upon x of omega, which is considered as h of omega, this h of omega is known as frequency response of your LTI system. Now from given h of omega, which we call as frequency response, we can divide it into two categories. So whenever h of omega is known to you, what I'll do is I'll take a mod of it. So whenever you take mod of h of omega, it will look like this. Am I right? And in second case, what I'll do is I'll take angle of h of omega. So I'll take angle of h of omega. So please understand, what is known to me is in general h of omega, on which I'll perform two operations, that is mod of h of omega, angle of h of omega. Now this mod of h of omega is called as a magnitude response. So with this magnitude response, I'll have mod of h of omega on y-axis and omega on x-axis. So whatever plot I'll get over here is called as a magnitude response. Similarly, angle of h of omega is called as a phase response. Like a magnitude phase response, a phase response, that is angle of h of omega, we will take on y-axis and naturally on x-axis we will have omega. And by varying omega, you may get some response at h of omega and some response at angle of h of omega, and then they are called as a magnitude response and phase response. So I'm sure now you understood what is meant by a frequency response of LTI system. So I'll repeat what we said. For LTI system, assume x of t input, y of t output, and impulse response is h of t. And how we related them? Y of t is x of t convolution with h of t. When we took Fourier transform on both the sides, y of t has become y of omega, x of t has become x of omega, convolution becomes product, h of t becomes h of omega is ratio of Fourier transform of output upon Fourier transform of input. So when I say h of omega is frequency response, from which I'll get two responses, a magnitude response and phase response. So we'll study them in detail now. So now we are interested to see how LTI system responds to sinusoidal inputs. So when I say input is sinusoidal, it means possible inputs I'm writing. Input can be like this, that is A times cos of omega naught t, or it can be A times sine of omega naught t, or possibly you can have A e to the power j omega naught t. Try to understand, all of them are considered to be a sinusoidal signal. You shouldn't get question, so you are seeing a sinusoidal signal and you are writing for cos. Let me tell you, sinusoidal and cos signal are not that different. There is only a phase shift. Otherwise, both of them keeps on oscillating between a maximum positive and maximum negative value. So these are possible inputs for which now I'm interested to see how my LTI system reacts on them. Okay, so for example, when I'm talking about a very first signal, I have to see how my LTI system reacts to this signal. So for first, I'll get output as A times M cos of omega naught t plus phi. Now let us observe something. Can you see that the amplitude initially, that is for x of t I'm talking about, it was A, but now amplitude of output is A times M. Am I right? Similarly, we have frequency over here is omega naught, and still in output frequency doesn't change. And let me tell you, this is the property of LTI system. Input frequency and output frequency is always same. So if I say input frequency is omega naught, output frequency will be omega naught only. What is only changed is phase. So let me tell you what is extra over here. Phase, and this is some magnitude. Am I right? What does that mean is, whenever you give a sinusoidal input to LTI system, its frequency is going to remain same even at output. Even though you are processing your input, still frequency of the signal is not going to change. So what is going to change? Only two things. First, amplitude, and second, phase. And by how much amount your magnitude is going to change? It is A times M, where A is the initial amplitude, M is the magnitude by which it is going to change. Same theory now you can apply for rest of the two inputs also. So for A sine omega naught t, so initial amplitude, if I say A, a new amplitude will be A times M, where M is a magnitude. Then it remains at sine with same frequency, that is omega naught t, plus some phase is added, and this is what we call it as phase. So again, this M stands for magnitude, phi stands for phase. Even third category is also a sinusoidal input. Then for this, you know that only two things are going to change, that is amplitude. So amplitude gets multiplied with M, e to the power j, in bracket now I can write omega naught t plus phi. So as you can see, in all three outputs, I have encircled only two things, that is magnitude and phase. And if this magnitude and phase is known to you, then it is very easy to predict the output for a given input. Am I right? So only two things should be known to you, that is M and phi. So our aim is to see how to calculate M and phi. Because once the value of M and phi is known to you for a given input, you can easily calculate output. Is that right? And let me tell you once again, our discussion is limited to only LTI system. A system has to be linear as well as time invariant system. Only then our discussion is valid. So the question is how to calculate, let's say, M and phi. So step one is to calculate frequency response. In the previous slide, we have already seen a frequency response is nothing but h of omega. Am I right? Sometimes h of omega is also represented as h of j omega. You shouldn't get confused. It is one and the same thing. So it is h of omega. That's what we called as a frequency response. Step 2. Get mod of h of omega. Now what is mod of h of omega? This is what we called as a magnitude response. Am I right? Now once mod of h of omega, that is a magnitude response, is known to you, now we can easily calculate m. M stands for magnitude. That is factor by which your input magnitude changes or input amplitude changes. So m is equal to mod of h of omega. You know that even mod of h of omega will be function of omega, meaning that mod of h of omega will have some equation in which there would be a presence of omega, in which you have to substitute omega equal to omega naught. And let me remind you, this omega naught is nothing but input frequency. What is meant by input frequency? You are applying some signal, x of t will have some frequency. Why it will have some frequency? Yes, because we are talking about a sinusoidal signal. A sinusoidal signal is a signal which keeps on oscillating with a particular frequency. That frequency is called as omega naught. So if you substitute omega equal to omega naught in mod of h of omega, then you get the value of m. So this is how we get the value of m. Now we'll move to step 3. So in step 2, if you have calculated magnitude response, naturally you will calculate a phase response in step 3. So get angle of h of omega. This is called as a phase response. Now once you calculate phase response, it is easy to calculate angle phi, which is again angle of h of omega at omega equal to omega naught, and of course omega naught is your input frequency. And what about output frequency? We know that when it comes to LTI system, input frequency is same as output frequency. In fact, we should say in a reverse way, output frequency remains same as input frequency. So this is how we get m and phi. And once you have the value of m and phi, you know how to get the output, right? So let us understand what is meant by a distortionless LTI system. So again, this is LTI system for which, let us say, input is x of t, output is y of t. So even in general, irrespective whether it LTI, whether it is LTI or not, a distortionless system is that system where shape of the input remains same even in output. That is, for example, you have applied some sinusoidal input at x of t, then even at output you will get a sinusoidal signal. Maybe it is different in magnitude or phase, so it could be even smaller than what you have applied at input. So for first input, these are two possible outputs. So as you can see, whether it is higher in magnitude or smaller in magnitude or maybe different in phase, a sinusoidal signal should remain a sinusoidal signal. Shape of the signal shouldn't change. For example, if you apply some square wave, a possible output can be like this or even like this. So as you can see, shape of input is not changed. So whenever a shape of input is not changed, when you see the output, in that case, you can say that your system is a distortionless system, right? So this is the concept of a distortionless system. So now I can claim for a distortionless system, I can say in general, y of t should be equal to same as that of x of t. Shape-wise, I'm saying, I'm not saying y of t and x of t are same. I'm saying shape-wise, output and input are same. Okay, so in two things, your input gets altered, that is a magnitude and phase. So I can say that your input gets multiplied by k, because of which the magnitude changes. And most of the system, whenever they are passed through some system, then you get some delayed version in the output. So possibly this happens that it is x of t minus t naught. So this is the output requirement for any distortionless system where your input changes in magnitude as well as maybe in phase. Okay, so not necessary this has to be always minus t naught, it can be plus t naught also, in case if you are using an advancing system. But most of the system, if you are not using some advancing system, whatever input you apply, some delay gets occurred, because of which you get a delayed version of input at output. So this is most of the time, this case is true for a distortionless system. So y of t is equal to k times x of t minus t naught. So now we will take this generalized output and we will study this distortionless LTI system in detail. So what I'll do is, I'll take a Fourier transform on both sides. So what I'll get? For y of t, I'll get y of omega. K is constant. We know that for x of t, we have Fourier transform as x of omega. But for x of t minus t naught, by using a time shifting property, it is e to the power minus j omega t naught times x of omega. Is that right? Now from this, what I'll do is, I'll shift this x of omega to left hand side, so as to get ratio of Fourier transform of output upon Fourier transform of input. This is known as a frequency response h of omega, which is now equal to k times e to the power minus j omega t naught. Finally, I can write. So this h of omega is your frequency response. Am I right? And you know that from frequency response, you will get two responses, that is a magnitude response and phase response. So let us get a magnitude response. So magnitude response means it is mod of h of omega. By observation, one can understand magnitude is simply k. And if you look at phase response, by observation, you can write angle of h of omega, it's simply minus omega t naught. Or you can write this way, minus t naught times omega. So the question can be, how do I get this magnitude and phase response? See carefully. If you observe this carefully, this is nothing but a polar value, or this is in a polar form. In general, polar form is like this, r e to the power j phi, where r stands for magnitude. So can I say that e to the power j phi's coefficient is nothing but a magnitude? So here, the coefficient is k. So k becomes naturally a magnitude. Am I right? Whereas this phi is called as a phase. So when I say phi stands for phase, so phi is nothing but a coefficient of j, am I right? A coefficient of j. So here, coefficient of j is what? It is not only omega t naught, it is minus omega t naught, am I right? So I have written a magnitude response and phase response just by observation. Now I'm interested to plot a magnitude response and phase response. First of all, I'll go for a plot of magnitude response. So we have got this as magnitude response, where mod of h of omega is equal to k. So on y-axis, we will have a magnitude, and on x-axis, we will have omega. Of course, we will have omega because on x-axis, we take independent variable. So in this case, if you see a magnitude, which is k, and can I say k stands for constant and it is independent of omega? I repeat, mod of h of omega is k. K means constant and it is independent of omega. Even though your omega is varied from minus infinity to infinity, irrespective of that, the magnitude remains constant, that is k. So I can plot my magnitude response straight away like this. So as you can see, it is throughout constant with magnitude equal to. So now I'll have a phase response plot. So we have already seen angle of h of omega is minus t naught times omega. Am I right? So on y-axis, we will have angle of h of omega. And on x-axis, we will have omega. So now I'm going to plot this angle of h of omega with respect to omega. So if you observe, we have taken angle of h of omega on which axis? It is on y-axis. On x-axis, what do you find? Omega. So can I write this omega as x? And since this minus t naught is constant, I would say in general it is m. And whenever we say y equal to mx, it is nothing but a equation of straight line. Equation of straight line with negative slope means a line which goes down. Y equal to mx, where if slope is positive, then it is a positively growing line. And since it is a negatively growing line, I'll get a response like this. A line passing through origin with slope equal to minus t naught. Am I right? So why this is line passing through origin? Because the line, if it is mx plus c, only in that case we have some y-intercept. So c stands for y-intercept, am I right? If this c happens to be 0, it means a line passes through origin. So y equal to mx is a straight line passing through origin. Since the slope m is equal to minus t naught, in fact negative, therefore a line is going down with respect to omega. So as soon as omega starts increasing, the phase angle starts decreasing. So we get this kind of line. So you can see and observe a magnitude response and phase response, and now you can come to conclusion for a distortionless system. Because this magnitude response and phase response have come from a distortionless generalized equation. Am I right? So if this generalized equation is followed, only then you will get such type of magnitude response and such type of phase response. Now I'm going to make a vice versa statement. If you have such type of magnitude response and phase response, only then the given system is said to be a distortionless system. Okay. So now I'll write the conclusion. So this line is very, very important. See to it what I've written. If the magnitude of mod of h of omega is constant for all values of omega, as you can see, even though you're varying your omega, even though magnitude is not changing because it is independent of omega, am I right? In that case only, you can say that there is no magnitude distortion, or your magnitude response is distortionless, okay? So this is only about the magnitude. Let us talk about a phase. So now in general, for phase response, you can comment like this. Your phase response should be linear in nature. So now even this conclusion is very, very important. If the phase response, that is angle of h of omega, is linear in nature, then there is no phase distortion. In your system, if there is no magnitude distortion as well as there is no phase distortion, only and only then your whole system is said to be a distortionless system. So the definition of distortionless system is that in magnitude response, you should get a magnitude which is independent of omega. It should be throughout same for all type of frequencies, as well as when it comes to a phase response, your phase response must be linear in nature. Only in that case, there is no phase distortion, no magnitude distortion, no phase distortion. Only then the whole system is said to be a distortionless system, right? So let's solve some problems. This is GATE 2007 problem. The frequency response of a linear time invariant system, so they are talking about LTI system, is given by h of f equal to 5 upon 1 plus j 10 pi f. The step response of the system is, so if you notice something, this is, even though they are saying a frequency response, which generally we have studied as h of omega, your h of omega is not given. What is given to you is h of f, okay? And of course, f and omega are nothing but frequencies. The only difference in their units, that is f is frequency in hertz, omega is also a frequency, but since it is measured in radians per second. And to avoid any confusion, if in the exam, if it appears that h of f is given, for your convenience, you can calculate h of omega. So our duty is to get h of omega from h of f. And how you are going to do this? By replacing f equal to omega upon 2 pi. It's very simple, because omega is equal to 2 pi f, then of course f is equal to omega upon 2 pi. Now I can write my h of omega as phi upon 1 plus j 10 pi, and now in place of f you will write as omega upon 2 pi. So here pi pi get cancelled. What is remaining? H of omega as 5 upon 1 plus j 5 omega. Am I right? So this is h of omega we have got, that is 5 upon 1 plus j 5 omega. So what I'm doing, I'm taking 5 common from denominator. So what I'll get over here is 1 by 5 plus j omega. Here 5 5 gets cancelled. Finally, h of omega is equal to 1 upon 1 by 5 plus j omega. Why I have done this? Why I have taken 5 common from the denominator? Because you know, now whatever form that you see of h of omega is a standard form. So if you remember, this is now comparable with 1 upon a plus j omega form. Am I right? You know that 1 upon a plus j omega, if you take a inverse Fourier transform, you get e to the power minus at dot u of t. So by using this logic, now I'll take inverse Fourier transform. So from h of omega, you're supposed to get h of t, which is e to the power minus 1 by 5 t dot u of t. So now this is called as impulse response of the system. If you read the question, they are not asking you for impulse response. They are clearly asking for unit step response. Am I right? They are asking you for a unit step response. So now it is easy for us, because if we know what is impulse response, it is easy to get a step response. So this is the relation between a step response and impulse response. So by integrating impulse response, we get a step response. So let me write the formula. From minus infinity to t, h of tau d tau, then you will get a step response. So h of t is already known to me, but for integration purpose we require h of tau. So it is simply just by replacing t with tau, you get h of tau. We know that a unit step input, that is u of tau, is present from 0 to infinity only. Am I right? Because u of tau response, if you see, it is like this. And of course, in the integration, whenever there is a presence of a step input, it always changes the limit. Okay. So there is no point to have a negative scale of time over here. Therefore, we are not going to integrate it from minus infinity. We are going to integrate it from 0. So now step response equal to, now instead of integrating from minus infinity, I'm going to integrate from 0 to t. What we have inside is e to the power minus 1 by 5 tau. And you know that right from 0 to infinity, value of u of tau is always 1. So there is no need to write u of tau. Value of it is equal to 1. So we have d tau here. Let us perform a normal integration. It is same, that is e to the power minus 1 by 5 tau divided by constant, which is minus 1 by 5. And the lower limit is 0, upper limit is t. So I can take 5 as constant out. But instead of taking minus 5, I'm taking plus 5 out. So instead of performing higher limit minus lower limit, I'll perform lower limit minus higher limit. So lower limit is 0. So it is e to the power 0 minus higher limit is e to the power minus 1 by 5 times t. Is that right? So this is equal to 5 times e to the power 0 is 1 minus e to the power minus 1 by 5 times t. So this is nothing but your step response. Am I right? Now if you refer the options, you will see this one of the option, but this is an incomplete option until and unless I specify u of t also here. So now I'll explain how I write u of t over here. You know that since we had a presence of u of tau, am I right? You had a presence of u of tau. So condition is that u of tau does exist only for a positive scale of time. I repeat, u of tau exists only for a positive scale of time. A positive scale of time means that this product will be non-zero only if t greater than 0. Am I right? So whatever we are discussing henceforth from this integration, everything is valid only for t greater than 0. So whenever a particular answer, you claim that it is valid only for t greater than 0, else it is equal to 0. It means now you can include u of t to show that. So remember that I can write this answer in two ways. That is, first way, 5 times 1 minus e to the power minus 1 by 5 times t. Now let's say I don't have to, you know, include u of t, but then mathematically I have to write that this is valid only for t greater than 0. Now if you don't want to specify that this is valid for t greater than 0, instead you can write the same thing, that is 5 times 1 minus e to the power minus 1 by 5 times t dot u of t. So it is one and the same thing. So let us see the correct option. So by observation, we can understand that option B is the correct option, that is 5 times 1 minus e to the power minus t by 5 times u of t. If you have noticed that most of the options looks similar. So even if you do a bit mathematical mistake, that instead of taking 5 out, if you take 1 by 5 out, even then you are going to have one of the option. So you have to be very careful when you are solving a gate problems. So let's see a last problem. A linear time invariant causal system has a frequency response given in polar form. So they have given some frequency response. They claim that it is in polar form. For input x of t equal to sine of t, output is. So by observation, you will understand that this is a linear time invariant system. So this is LTI system. For this LTI system, this is your impulse response. For this LTI system, this is your frequency response, which is h of omega. This h of omega they have given in polar form as r at an angle of phase, out of which r stands for magnitude and this angle stands for phase. And they have given some sinusoidal input, that is sine t. And this section we have already studied in this lecture only, how LTI system responds to a sinusoidal input. So when in general input x of t is a sine omega naught t, then output of LTI system y of t is what? It is a times m sine of omega naught t plus phi. Is that right? So this is something that we have already learned. Now see, what is your x of t? Your x of t is sine t. So I'm writing over here, what is given x of t is sine t. Is that right? So now if you compare with a standard form, you get two values. That is, value of a is equal to 1 and the value of omega naught is equal to 1 radian per second. So I got two factors, that is value of a and value of omega. So value of a is known to me and value of omega naught is known to me. Now only thing is I have to calculate m magnitude and phase, and then I'll see which option is correct. We have already studied magnitude m is nothing but mod of h of omega substitute omega equal to omega naught, where omega naught stands for input frequency. So here it is equal to mod of h of omega at omega equal to 1, because input frequency is 1. And if you see h of omega, the magnitude is given as 1 upon under root of 1 plus omega square. Here I'll substitute omega equal to 1. So whenever you substitute omega equal to 1 over here, it becomes 1 by root 2. This is magnitude m. Similarly, angle phi is calculated from angle of h of omega. And if you observe, angle of h of omega is given as minus tan inverse of omega. You have to calculate again omega at equal to omega naught. So here omega equal to omega naught value is 1. So it is equal to minus tan inverse of 1. You know that tan inverse of 1 is 45 degree. So this is equal to minus, we already had, minus 45 degree. Or in terms of radian, you can write as minus pi by 4 radian. Look at the option. Phases are given in terms of radian. So I have to take minus pi by 4 as phase. In general, y of t is what? It is a times m sine of omega naught t plus phi. In that case, y of t is equal to value of a was 1. Value of magnitude that we have is 1 by root 2. We have sine. Omega naught stands for input frequency, which is 1. So I need not to write 1 over here. I'll just write t. Plus phase, but phase is negative, so a negative sign will come over here, that is minus pi by 4. So finally I can write y of t is 1 by root 2 sine of t minus pi by 4. So 1 by root 2 sine of t minus pi by 4 is your option D. So option D is the correct option. So I'm sure you have understood how LTI system reacts to a sinusoidal input. You have understood what is a frequency response. From frequency response, how to get a magnitude response and phase response, and by observing magnitude response and phase response, how to identify that it is a distortionless system. These things, these points are very, very important from the point of view. Thank you.